Nineveh was a very large city. It took 3 days to go through it. Jonah began by going a day's journey into the city, proclaiming, 40 more days and Nineveh will be overthrown. The Ninevites believed God. A fast was proclaimed in all of them, from the greatest to the least, who chose God. When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he relented and did not bring on them the destruction he had threatened. This is the word of the
Lord. Thanks be to God.
Without delay, he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men. think of Ernie Chip. I'm sure you can think of them also. Where we did, of course, and the story of Jim. I know that technically, Moby Dick is not a fish, he's a man. And although the humor of the book of Jonah refers to a great fish, most readers take the creature to be a whale in order for it to be able to do the things it's described as doing. I also suppose that we would have to concede that the Gospels do not say that much about fish. But they do not say nothing about them. Jesus sees the fishermen on the Sea of Galilee, as recorded by Mark, as we just heard, and also the other gospel writers. And John even weaves fish into his resurrection narrative, with his seashore fish breakfast cooked by Jesus in his appearance to the fishermen disciples, who had gone back to their professional calling after the shattering events of Jesus' crucifixion and its extraordinary aftermath. John describes them as having caught a huge catch, 153 large fish. And there are resonances in that incident with what Mark records at the beginning of his gospel, that Jesus' followers will become catchers of men or people, and the number of them will be great. On the face of it, you could say that what attracted the compilers of the lectionary to pairing the Jonah story with the Mark chapter 1 story was probably the common factor of fish. We would assume that the gospel story in some sense completes or interprets the Old Testament story, and that the meaning has something to do with the role of the fish in each account. But the connection is not necessarily that obvious. After all, in the Jonah story, it's the fish that captures the man. Whereas in the gospel story, it's the men that catch the fish. If we stick with the fish, the way through to the real connection doesn't seem that clear. Sticking for a moment, therefore, with the Jonah story, although the fish is an unavoidably significant player in the drama, the point of the story is not really about the fish. It's about Jonah's narrow-mindedness. He was outraged by the suggestion that the heathen inhabitants of Nineveh might actually repent and receive God's gracious forgiveness and his generous approval. Surely, according to Jonah's conventional Israelite spirituality, God's grace was the exclusive of his chosen people. For it to be shared willy-nilly with heathens, foreigners, was to debase it and to drag God down into the mire of the pigsty, which is the obvious implication if you cast the pearls of the grace of God before the swine of his enemies. That's the unavoidable logic of a theology which seeks to make the grace of God the possession only of his chosen people. And we must come back to that fundamental point in a minute. Meanwhile, as Jesus makes his way along the shore, he sees men out fishing. Mark doesn't tell us whether he already knew these men, although it's perfectly possible that he did. Perhaps they had already spent time with him, sitting around, arguing and pontificating about the unfairness of Roman rule, the back-breaking nature of their work as fishermen, and their hopes that the God of Israel would soon right all the wrongs that disfigured their lives and the life of their community. That would certainly help to explain their willingness to abandon everything and commit themselves to whatever it was about this attractive and inspiring stranger who seemed to understand it, and whose vision of what the true sovereignty of God in that place might look like had captured and inspired their imaginations. So they left their nets and followed it. And there we have the template that's become the pattern, the demonstration, the outworking of Christian discipleship. Christians are those who follow. And it's Jesus that they follow, just like those simple fishermen. set the agenda, expressing individuality, independence, self-sufficiency. All those millions of Instagram followers would much rather be the one they follow than the anonymous and rather mystical foot soldiers that they actually are. And here we are saying that life in all its fullness is only possible if you follow, not if you lead. And it gets worse, because the promise that Jesus makes is that if you follow him, you will not find life to be comfortable, secure, and undemanding. The foxes have holes and the birds their nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. He does not say, follow me, and I will make you feel good about yourself. He does not say, follow me, and I will take all your troubles away. He does not say, follow me, and I will give you health and wealth. He actually says, follow me, and I will make you fishers of people, or men, as the old-fashioned translations put it. Following him, therefore, is not about embarking on a journey into the self. In fact, it has nothing to do with the self, if by self we mean giving in to the insistent inner voice that warns against risk, that chooses the safe and the predictable, and which ultimately will not allow itself to be dethroned from the position of control, its ownership, what it thinks is its agenda. To follow the Son of God is to become like the Son of God, to share his life and his destiny. And because the Son of God in his sonness is God in his self-giving, God in his outwardness, God in his overflowing giving of himself away, he is the God who shows that life is gained when it is lost.
Like
difficult to reconcile with the Catherine wheel paradigm, in which life is gained or owned when it's thrown outwards, when it's about fishing, where storms might blow up, about being out of our comfort zone, about being salt and light where there is blandness and darkness. That does not mean that what happens in here is not important. The contrast I'm drawing should not be overplayed. We need to meet together to worship and hear what God is saying to us, through our Christian neighbor, and through the experience of worshiping together with one another. But what we do here is not ultimately for us. What we do here is not ultimately for us. It is for the world. Because we are here, because we are those who are tasked with fishing. For men, women, boys, girls. Where they are, which is not here. In this strict sense, therefore, the church is not for Christians. The church is not for its members. Because those who are together, the thing we call St. Andrew's, are those who follow Jesus. And in that following are made into those who give themselves away for those who do not yet follow him. Who do not even want to follow him. Who don't even know that they don't yet want to follow him. So the actual life of St. Andrew's in its appointed calling within the creation renewing purposes of God does not take place here. Or at least its outworking does not take place here. It takes place in your homes, your workplaces, and in the comings and goings of the paths where your daily responsibilities take you, in the interactions which are the acting out of your prayers for those in need. Jonah thought that God confined his ambitions for humankind to the part of humankind that he, Jonah, happened to be a privileged member of. Through the willing cooperation of a fish, he was introduced to a much bigger conception of the gracious purposes of God. He was made to see that God's grace is not confined to his people and is not simply for his people. It is for all, through his people. If you were a well-known and respected rabbi in what we now call the late BC and early AD era, you tended to accumulate followers who attached themselves to you so that they could learn from your knowledge of the scriptures and of your own wisdom. They would quite literally sit at your feet so that they could hear you expounding on the law. The really enthusiastic students would express their allegiance to you not only by listening attentively, but by also adopting, consciously or unconsciously, your habits of speech, your mode of dress, and even the idiosyncrasies of how you walk. So, if you lived, they would live. If you shuffled, they would shuffle. Apparently, it was possible to say which rabbi a student followed simply by watching how they walked when they went out of the bed and nowhere near their rabbi. I'm not sure whether someone observing me while I am out and about would be able to recognize by the way I walk through life which rabbi it is that I follow. That thought is uncomfortable, but it's a thought that I have to take seriously if I am to consider myself an authentic follower of Jesus. not an end in itself. It is good for the sake of the other. It is designed to make us able to walk when we are not here, when we are out there, where walking must be done, and done in a certain way. The way of Jesus, the way of the cross.
Christ is our peace. If anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, everything has become new. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Gracious Lord, to accept the offering of your church, the hearts of your people, joined in praise and thanksgiving, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Lord.
Amen.
The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Supper was ended. He took a cup of wine, and then he praised you. He gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice lay once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life, the cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ is born again. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people. Gather us in your loving arms and bring us with all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ.
his blood which he shed for me. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for me, and feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. Most merciful Lord, your love for us is
Thank you.
servant, as the government department which looks after and tries to help and generally supports churches, other religious groups within our government. And they are very engaged, of course, with those churches, groups, temples, social clubs and so on, in the role that they can play in helping with the pandemic, and in particular with the vaccination. Many of you all know that last Friday there was a vaccination program going on at the Evangelical Church, and you were invited to go and take advantage of that if you wanted to. The subject matter at the meeting was Return to Normality. Captivating title. Why wouldn't you attend a meeting called that? But it was clear, of course, that there's a strong connection, almost a complete connection, between that, return to normality, and vaccination. So I'm not telling you to get vaccinated, it's not my job. You make up your own minds about that. But it's also important that as religious leaders, as we're called, we play our part in letting you know that the government wants there to be a return to normality, but in their minds, perfectly logically, that's completely tied up with the success of the vaccination program. So think about it. If you haven't got yourself vaccinated, please think about it. I'm not telling you to do it, but anyway, I'm fulfilling my responsibility as a religious leader to inform you about it. Okay? The other thing is this. Thank you very much, guys. In one of four, there's a group called Pray for Abu Dhabi. It's come into being relatively recently, and it's an ecumenical group of people who feel that prayer, praying together, all Christians of all sorts of backgrounds and denominations and styles, that it's an important activity to do. And particularly at this time, when we are in a context where there are quite extraordinary things going on, which relate to the freedom with which the Christian community and other communities can play a part in building the wider community in the eyes of the government. And prayer, of course, is a vital factor in that. So it's really a two-pronged thing here. Please search out Prayer for Abu Dhabi, see if you don't mind taking part in that program of prayer. It's just a cycle of prayer, and you just sign up to pray for 20 minutes or whatever time it is in the week. That's one thing. And they have this conference on, it's an online event, of course, happening tomorrow and the day after. So check it out through the usual methods and attend if you want to. Register, of course. So anything else?
Is the video you want to have it?
There's a video, you mean now?
It's 2 minutes.
Yeah, yeah. Can we access the video, Kim? While that we're checking that out, I should also say that there's updated information in our newsletter on the Facebook page, so check the newsletter as well.
May God the Father, who led the wise man by the shining of a star to find the Christ, the light for light, lead you also in your pilgrimage to find the Lord.
Amen.
May God the Son, who turned water into wine at the wedding feast in Cana, transform your lives and make glad your hearts.
Amen.
who have come to the waters of the new birth.
Amen.
And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. To love and to serve the Lord.